Hi, my name is Maya Kepfer, and I am a completely normal person. Yeah, completely normal. I mean, you have to know that. But society doesn't have a great definition of what normalcy consists of. I mean, think about it. What is normalcy to you? Adults, you kind of are running on this treadmill with no safety key to, hypothetically speaking, save you from falling on your face. So, I mean, you juggle your kids, your financials, your job on a daily basis. But your kids struggle too, with maybe a sport, their grades, their friends. To us, this is our normalcy, because it's all we've ever known how to do. Now, there's a very popular phrase that I'm sure you've all heard, is that you can't judge a book by its cover. And in a way, this implies that you can't know someone's story unless you actually talk to them, but you can get a pretty good idea. And our brains are quite perceptive in this way. The human brain takes approximately 152 milliseconds to process a single thought. Every person is unique in their methods of recognition and perception of thoughts. Each day, you think hundreds of thousands of thoughts based on common decisions and prior knowledge. Just think, you got out of bed today. You hopefully brushed your teeth and put clothes on before you came to watch these speeches. And you asked if someone was doing it, but you didn't have to do any of these things. But every so often, you are faced with a problem that you did not choose for yourself. Decisions your mind or your body just kind of chose for you. Nobody just decides one day to wake up with a mental illness. Now, depression is the 10th leading cause of suicide, determined by the National Strategy for Suicide Prevention Board, 10. Approximately 450 million people around the world suffer from a mental illness. That's about 1 in every 10 people, 5% of our global population. 5%, that's a pretty big number if you think about it. And about 80% of these cases can be effectively treated with brief structured forms of psychotherapy and antidepressant medications. Why did I bring up normalcy? To me, the moment that you ask for help is the moment you are closest to being normal. Because you are admitting you are no longer capable of maintaining these horrible feelings alone. Now, some people describe depression itself as unrelenting and overwhelming. Some don't feel sad at all, just kind of lifeless or empty. Kind of felt this way this morning, realizing I had to come here and give a TED talk. To me, depression is like drowning. And I want to come back to this, but I want to tell a quick little story about my dad. My dad is my best friend. And he's sitting somewhere in the back, so maybe you can say hi to him before you go. And you can see the resemblance. And when I was little, he used to draw places in our house, like our kitchen or our living room. But he'd never used darker colors, and as a kid, I didn't really understand that. I'd always ask, Dad, why don't you use like black or brown? I don't know, like a dark color. He said they were too overwhelming. I was 8 years old. What does overwhelming mean? Well, to this day, my parents are separated. When I was 12, I was in sixth grade, my very first day of sixth grade, and they told me they were separating. And I fell into a very depressive state. But wouldn't you be depressed too if your parents told you they were splitting up? So depression to me was like drowning. Drowning in a sea of black paint. If you've ever used or seen black paint, it is so purely dark. I mean, the definition of black is absence of color or the complete absorption of light. That's pretty much how I felt every day. And depression, it's hitting you in waves of unanswered questions and regrets as it pushes you further and further from the shore full of color and happiness. It's pretty dark right now, but I'm good now. Less than 33% of people who feel this kind of way seek help. But why is this? There is no single cause to a mental illness. There can be a hormone imbalance, you can get it genetically from a family member. There could be a physical or substantial abuse. There's some other things listed there. There is no single cause, and it's very hard to diagnose. I was never diagnosed, so just keep that in mind. But the best way to diagnose this is to address these problems head on. Instead of waving away a possibility of mental illness, just stop and ask someone how they're doing. But don't do it unless you're willing to actually listen. And another quick story that I'd like to say. I grew up a devout Catholic school kid. I went to St. Joan of Arc School for 10 years. And we go to church services every Sunday. And around Easter time, we have special ones, if weather permits, outside. And my mom and I, we went to one, and this little girl, she was walking around in front of us, and she kept picking up sticks and bugs and getting scolded by her mother for it. And it was funny because we walked through this patch of dandelions and all those like pretty yellow blossoms and a few of the white feathered ones. And we're watching to see which one she's gonna pick up. And she finally saw one, and we knew that she liked it because she literally dragged her mother through the grass and mud to where we were standing and picked up what I realized was a white dandelion. And it surprised me because out of all of those pretty yellow blossoms, why'd she pick that white, gray, feathered one? Well, if you know a dandelion's life cycle, the yellow blossoms turn into the white feathery seeds that are blown away by the wind, and then the new dandelions. So this little girl, she picked up this dandelion because, first of all, it was no less important to her, and it was no less beautiful. And yet kids grow up and flowers die. That's not really the point. If half as many people stopped and cared to ask how people were doing in just their everyday lives, mental health illnesses would not be on the rise. People with a mental illness are looking for some kind of redemption in themselves, a redeeming quality or factor that makes their life worth something to others. And this quote describes perfectly how I feel about this situation. And it's by Cassandra Clare, one of my favorite authors. She said, "God knows we're all drawn to what's beautiful and what's broken." As I said before, this little girl picked up a flower that to her was just as important as any of the other flowers she saw. Think about it. Haven't we all answered the question, "How are you doing?" "I'm just tired," because you didn't feel like explaining how you felt. Because sometimes we don't want to be fixed. Instead of telling people to get over themselves, we need to get over ourselves. Because this is something that's happening in our everyday lives and it needs to be addressed. We live by this popular theme that someone else is happy, so I can't be. But when are we going to realize that this way of life is wrong? And the fact that this theme has contributed to people committing suicide, and it changes your entire perspective when someone jokes about wanting to kill themselves, because most of us have wanted to die. Because death just seemed like a mercy that was so perfect, because it meant we no longer had to breathe each breath feeling this way that we do. But let me specify something for you. It's not. And it never will be. Let me just say it again for the people who might not have heard me. Suicide is not mercy, and it never will be. Because then you have to struggle with the fact that those parents are never going to watch that child grow up, start a family, get a job, all because some kids just decided to be cruel, not realizing these people were already battling their inner demons that were just as bad. And one of my favorite TV show characters describes this so perfectly because he says, in the end, when you lose somebody and they leave you, every candle and every prayer isn't going to make up for the fact that the only thing left is a hole in your life where that somebody you cared about used to be. I don't know about you, but I don't want to hear another story about how unbearable a person's life with mental illness was and how they were driven to commit suicide because they think it was the only choice. It's not the only choice. If anything, it's the hardest way out because you never get to say goodbye to the people that love you the most. Let me specify something else. You are someone's child, someone's mother or father, someone's brother or sister or best friend. You are a guy that wears a bow tie to school every Tuesday. You are the girl that picks up dandelions during church services. You are someone that someone remembers in their own special way because your presence itself has impacted everyone around you. Don't sell yourself short on that worth. Because the minute you admit that you're worth more than you know is the minute you are normal. And normal might be boring to you, but we're all normal people with abnormal mindsets. That is the basis of who the human race is and will always be. There's a popular saying that says, if you fall down, try to land on your back, because if you can look up, you can get up. And yes, it's okay to fail at things, but it's never okay to quit. But how many times can you get back up when you are too broken to see any kind of light? Why push people away? We are drowning in words left unspoken. I can only hold my breath for so long. Because we all live these lives that are documentaries on fast forward, and then our peers have the audacity to tell us to grow up. People can tell you to stay strong, but they don't understand what you're feeling. On the outside, we look delicate, but on the inside, we are dying. I know how it feels, and I know how horrible it sounds. Believe me, I was there. And what seemed like my lowest point, I just wanted to press pause on my life. Not even pause, stop. So wake up, not only as individuals, but as a community. Because we are trapped in a society where we are ranked by how much we are feared by others. We are defined by the very same people whose textbook definition of beauty has nothing to do with us. We are lost. In a reality where mental illness is something people don't have. We live in this fear that if we don't hold back the pain, it will consume us. The bottom line is, mental illnesses are no joke. Clearly, we all haven't felt okay at some point in our lives. And let me put it this way. The average person will speak 860 million words in their lifetime. There are 86,400 seconds in a day. Why waste too long about what you feel? To this day, I am a 4.0 student. I take 10 dance classes a week. I have the most amazing friend group who loves and supports me. I have a boyfriend who puts up with my horrible attitude. My mom has never given up on me. My dad is still my best friend. My sister is my better half. And my favorite flower to this day will always be puffy white dandelions.